Welcome to Around the Diamond. I'm Marvin Jackson. Today we talk to Dusty Baker. Dusty is the manager of the Houston Astros, and he's been in the major leagues for quite a while as a player and manager. Recently, he hit a milestone and became the 14th winningest major league manager of all time. Let's meet Dusty Baker. All right, I am with Dusty Baker, manager of the Houston Astros and longtime major league manager. You just hit a milestone the other night, and that was your 1,900th victory as a manager. Talk about that, man, and how that felt to you.
Well, actually, it took about 4 or 5 days to get there. I've been knocking on that door for a while. I just feel grateful and fortunate to, you know, been around this long and to have as many jobs as I've had. You know, a couple of them, I don't know how I lost it, you know, or what took so long to get back, because there was there were three different intervals at 2 years of a piece equaling six that I couldn't even sniff a job. And I was coming off of a couple pennants a couple times, you know, and so, you know, but the Lord put me in this position. So sometimes you wonder what. I mean, I'm grateful. I'm happy to be in this position. But in my mind, I should have been in this position a long time ago. And but I'm happy here in Houston. You know, we got a good team. I'm still questing for that World Series championship. And I always said, if I get one, I'll get two. And so, you know, I better hurry up, you know, this year and next year. And hopefully by next year, I'll be in the 2000 club, which will be an even bigger honor than being in the 1900 club.
Right, right. Let's talk about coming to Houston. There were a lot of challenges there for you, not just as a manager, but taking over an organization that had some troubles. And, you know, talk about how tough that was for you and the tough decision of taking that team.
I mean, it was tough. It wasn't that tough of a decision, because every team I've taken over except the Washington Nationals, you know, was on the bottom. I mean, most of the time the jobs that we're going to get are jobs that you have to, you know, rescue a team. You know, and most of the time we're not going to get a team that's at that's at the top. So this was no different than the rest of the teams. It was a reclamation project, but it was a heck of a reclamation project, because these guys had a good team before I got here. We just had to deal with some things publicly. You know, we're still dealing with them. You know, different stadiums you go in. You know, we haven't made the circuit completely, the people are hard on the team. And you know, what most people don't understand is only four guys left off of that team, and so a lot of guys that's being booed that they're hissing at, you know, weren't even part of this or weren't even part of the team. And it also made it a little difficult sometimes to get free agents last year, because some of the free agents didn't want to be part of that action at the same time, which I've heard. So it has been difficult, but you know, it makes you stronger. You know, we got some heck of a guys here. I mean, some guys that are, you know, that are truly remorseful for what happened. It just seems like, you know, people don't, you know, just, you know, don't want to forgive. But like I said, as long as you make amends, you know, with your family, self, and God, to me, like I told these guys, those are only three entities that you can't fool. And so, you know, those three entities know if you're being sincere about how you feel and going forward, because you can't, you know, I think guilt is one of the worst emotions going, because that, you know, I had a brother. You know, that felt guilty about some money that we lost, and it haunted him for 30 years and ended up being a manic depressant. And I just, I truly believe that, you know, guilt is one of the worst emotions of all time. You got to ask for forgiveness and leave it back behind you.
Let's talk about a couple of these young guys that you have with Houston now. You've got some pretty good young guys with great potential. Talk about some of them.
And even the old guys aren't that old.
And they still have a lot of ball playing. I know you got a couple of young guys like Javier, the pitcher, and talk about some of those guys.
Well, you know, he pitched last night, and I mean, this guy's the limit. You know, I mean, you know, Correa's still young. You know, I mean, he's very young, and you know, Bregman's still young. I mean, all these guys are under 30 years old, and Tucker's like way young. You know, and Straw, and you know, we got guys like you know, Belak and Abreu. You know, they're not household names, but they will be, you know, at some point in time. And you know, the guy that's really going to be a household name that we're missing because he broke his finger in spring training is Framber Valdez. And Framber was our big winner, you know, last year. And so, you know, we're excited. You know, we got Urquidy. Urquidy's young too. He's only 25 years old from Mexico. So, and the sooner you get used to winning, and the sooner that you know what it feels like to win, then I think the future of this organization is very bright. As long as we fill in the blanks, you know, from what we need. Now, what did hurt us is losing the first round, second round draft choice for, you know, for 2 years, because those are usually impact players, you know, in your organization. So what we're gonna have to do, we're gonna have to be really astute on signing some people that might be under the radar or not on everybody's you know, top list.
You got some pretty competitive teams in your division. It's a pretty tight division. The Angels, the Mariners. You've got the A's have won about 10 in a row or something, right? I mean, they played very well since the beginning of the season. What happened with that turnaround with them? What do you think that was about?
Well, you know, I mean, you know, teams go in streaks, and the key is to play, you know, consistent baseball until you get in a streak. Hopefully that's their best streak of the year, because hey man, not many teams go on a 10 or 11 game winning streak. Mm-hmm. And so I'd like to think that ours is on the way. Mm-hmm. And you know, they got good pitching. It starts with good pitching, and then it ends with defense and hitting. And if you got good pitching, it's hard to go on a prolonged losing streak, because I mean, you know, like I said, they got some fine young arms over there. Texas Rangers are playing good, you know, a lot better than when they started. the Angels, you know, have a dynamic offense. It depends on the pitching. You know, it's the same with us. I mean, you know, pitching is the key. And who else did I admit? And Seattle's playing outstanding baseball, and they got a good young team, you know, led by one of my former players, Scott Service, you know, former Houston Astros, Scott Service is doing a great job. They got speed. They got some, you know, fine young pitching, and you know, they're coming in here after this series here. So, you know, I'd like to kind of beat them and beat them kind of handily before they start thinking that they're good. Cause see, if young guys start thinking that they're good, then they're really dangerous. Because I remember when the Braves, was fighting us, you know, back in the 90s. And when the Braves, I prayed, I said, Lord, please don't let the Braves win now, because if they start thinking that they're good, they could win for 10, 12 years, which they did. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they're similar to where the Astros were a few years ago, you know, when they had some fine young players. So, it's going to be a race. It's going to be a race to the end, and it's going to be fun, you know, being such a race.
And it's happening like that all over Major League Baseball. Tell me, Dusty, after pitching, what do you think is the most important thing that you would want?
Defense.
Defense. You
know, yeah, because the defense, you don't win games on defense, but you lose them on defense. And you start giving away extra outs, then something bad is going to happen to you. You know what I mean? And you're not going to hit every day. You know, you look at the Dodgers. I mean, you know, they got a dynamite offense. They score a lot of runs, but they've also shut out, you know, have like two or three 1-0 shutouts. And so pitching pitching, defense, and I love speed, but there's not very much speed in the game anymore. That, you know, I think we got to get back to some speed.
More of that.
Oh yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. Much more of that, and usually that comes with, you know, Latin American players or African American players. You know, there's no speed in the game. Well, but there's no African American players. You know, most of the speed's in football and basketball. And, you know, like I remember the Cardinals back in the day, man, Willie McGee and Ozzie Smith, and they say speed kills. Mm-hmm. And it does. It makes you make mistakes that you wouldn't ordinarily make. And, you know, to have a well-rounded team, you need some speed, you need some power, you need some defense. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love to see that ball go with a fist, especially on our side. And I love, you know, hitting some home runs, but I tell when I was a hitter, but as Joe Black told me one time when I was kind of struggling, he told me, he said, Dusty, remember that you're a hitter and not a slugger. And, you know, you're a hitter with some slugger's power, but number one thing that you're a hitter. And that's the same thing I try to pass on to my players now.
All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back and talk about maybe getting more diversity in baseball and some of the people who were influenced you when you were coming up. So we'll be right back with Dusty Baker. Don't go away.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. In that small cafe, the park across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut trees, the wishing well. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is blue, I'll be looking at the moon, and I'll be seeing you. I'll be looking at the moon, and I'll be seeing you.
Marvin Jackson back here on Around the Diamond with Dusty Baker. And Dusty, you started to talk about some of the things that are missing in baseball, and maybe if there were more Latin players and more African-American players, you would get some of that. And you were talking about things like speed and that kind of thing. Talk about how that can happen. Maybe I know there's a new Players Alliance. That's something I think is really good. You can tell me if you think it's good, but there's a Players Alliance and there are a lot of players of color in that group. But talk about that, maybe how to get more diversity in Major League Baseball.
Well, I mean, I love the Players Alliance and, you know, I love, you know, my Latin brothers, but the game has plenty of Latin players. I think it's like, mm-hmm. like 43% Latin. Mm-hmm. But that's only 6 or 7% African American. I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that, you know, a lot of the African American kids don't have anybody to emulate that looks like them, that speaks like them on TV. When I was a kid, I wanted to be Tommy Davis. And I remember, you know, and I ended up wearing his number, playing the same position. And I remember watching the teams like the Pirates, the Giants, the Braves, the Indians, certain teams. Had a number of African American players, the Cincinnati Reds, you know, that you could sort of say, "Hey, man, I want to be like, you know, I want to be like him." And
I wanted to be Lou Brock.
Oh yeah,
and
yeah.
I was a left-handed batter, outfielder. Oh,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Oh yeah, and also it's a matter of economics, I think, because it's expensive to play baseball now. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You know, they got a $300 or $400 glove and $200 or $300 bat. I mean, man, you know, there'd be one bat for the family. Mm-hmm. You know, if you could afford that. And also, I think they've gone to the point where college baseball like my son plays at the University of California, Berkeley, you know, you'll be lucky to find one to two African-American players, you know, per team, unless you're in a SWAC conference or one of the HBCUs, which don't seem to be signing or producing, you know, many players out of there. I'm sure that there are a number of players that can play. But, you know, with that being said, you know, Major League Baseball, I think, is using college baseball as a feeder, as well as the minor leagues, you know, you know, in my son's case, you know, he's a pretty good player, but he's like on a 50 or 60% scholarship. Well, you know, I could afford that, but how many parents can afford to pay 50% of tuition that might cost $30,000-$40,000? Well, yeah, you're getting a scholarship, but the family has to pay $15,000. So if you got a choice between going to play basketball and going to play football and getting a full scholarship, you know, which one are you gonna take? And I think that's why I say economics is probably as large a part of that, you know, as anything. And especially if you have two or three kids in the household, then, you know, how are you going to have, you know, two or three kids go travel around and travel ball and travel around to, you know, to these showcases and different things. So, you know, we got to make it possible, you know, like nobody wants a handout, but on the other hand, we got to make it possible, you know, for these kids to have an opportunity to, you know, to play, but they got to dream about it first. It starts by watching some of your heroes on TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Talk about what maybe the Alliance, what are the things that the Alliance is doing? The Players Alliance.
Well, the Players Alliance is you know, the league has something similar, which was FIRST, you know, which is run by Tony Regans and my godson, you know, Dale Matthews. But the Players Alliance is more, you know, recently retired players or players that are still playing, that, you know, they're trying to recruit players that are still playing to, you know, to make it possible for the young people to have better nutrition, to have better education, to have equipment, you know, to show them that, hey, you can make it. You know, when you got you know, the guys that are heading the Alliance, you got CC Sabathia and some of these guys are firsthand, you know, Curtis Granderson are recently retired, where all you gotta do is look them up if you don't know them, and they just retired a year or two ago, which is more recent. Like sometimes I can see when I'm talking about a player to pass, and I'll ask a modern player, hey man, you remind me of Lou Brock, and they'll say, I never heard of him. And I'll say, you remind me of so and so. And they're like, I never heard of him either. And I said, go look him up. And they're like, man. I said, go Google this guy. And I said, man, that dude is a bad dude. But you know, these guys are more recent, where you can ask somebody in the family or go look them up, and then they just retired a couple of years ago.
All right. And talk about all the recent things that are going on in our country. That must make it tougher for you managing these young guys, because you got a lot of young guys and a lot of them of color on your team even. Talk about how difficult that is, the challenge of managing them. And at the same time, you have a son who's an African-American. So talk about that.
And, you know, he's their age. He's 22 years old. Mm. And so, you know, I feel it's my duty to kind of, you know, educate, you know, some of the young guys, especially those that are curious, because what you're seeing is a reoccurrence of what happened in my generation, and even worse. And so if you don't educate them, then it can happen over and over again, and happen even in the next generation, you know, if people don't see, you know, the signs. But I think these young people are more together than we were, you know, as a whole, you know, regardless of what nationality you are, creed, color, religion, you know, like I felt good about America, and people always come down on young people. They came down on us. The world's going to come to an end. This generation, this and that. But when I see all these kids that are coming together in a common cause, you know, for equal rights and justice, it makes me feel good about our future. And so, you know, they ask me questions. You know, some of my former players ask me questions about kneeling or about, you know, the George Floyd situation or should they play? And I give them my honest opinion. And the fact that they ask and the fact that they called, you know, to ask my opinion means that they're on the fence and that they're, you know, they're curious about, you know, about an outcome. And so, but you also have to realize that, you know, if a guy disagrees with you, or if a guy has a different political feeling about things, that you have to accept that too, you know, because there are a lot of, I mean, our country is split 50-50, you know, between, you know, Biden and Trump. And, you know, the same feelings and problems that we might feel that we have in society is in our clubhouse as well, because our clubhouse is a microcosm of people. And so, you know, hopefully we can come together instead of being separated, and sports can help, as it seems like it's helped to do that.
All right. And you're probably the guy to do that, because you've been in baseball for quite a while and in different roles. I mean, as a player, as a manager. And let's talk about some of those people who guided you back in the day, because they're not with us any longer. We lost a few of them, Frank Robinson, Hank Aaron. Talk about that, man.
Well, I mean, they were major influences in my life. You know, I met Hank Aaron when I was 18 years old, and he promised my mother he'd take care of me as if I was his son. I didn't want to sign with the Braves because I didn't want to go to the South, because that was a time of, you know, civil unrest and anti-conformity to everything, Vietnam, race, you know, riots. I mean, everything in our, you know, in our country. And I didn't want to go to the South. And that was the best thing that happened to me, was the fact that I met Hank Aaron. He did indeed take care of me as if, you know, like he promised my mom. And then by knowing Hank Aaron, he's going for the record over the next couple of years, I got to meet the greatest civil, you know, rights activist in America, you know, at a very young age, you know, to be around Andrew Young and Maynard Jackson and Ted Abernathy and, you know, Herman Russell and, you know, everybody, you know, all the, you know, leaders in the South, you know, Jesse Jackson. I met them all and was in their company by being around Hank Aaron, which reinforced what my mom and dad used to tell me, but, you know, you don't really think the mom and dad know as much as they know until later on, or until somebody confirms it. Because my mom and dad were, you know, the head of the NAACP in my town of Riverside, California. And then they made me join the junior NAACP. And I'm like, well, mom, do I have to? And why? And then at a very young age, I saw why. And I saw why when I was in the South. And then when I came back from the California from the South, then I really saw in a number of ways that I was being fooled, because I was thinking I was in California, that things were different. And they were in no means any different. They were a little better, but they were a lot better actors where I was versus when I'm in the South. If they don't like you, they kind of let you know it like right away. So which one is worse, be around actors or to be around the people that just throw it in your face? And so, you know, there was a time when I was confused on a number of issues, and you know, straightened me out, and my dad straightened me out. And there were times like, you know, Mr. Bill Lucas with the Braves was our farm director. He was Hank's brother-in-law, you know, and then I had Frank Robinson as a manager, and I had Jim Gilliam, you know, as a coach. And I've always told people that their coaches are the most influential people almost in your life. They spend as much time with you as your parents or your minister or anybody. And I was very, very fortunate to have some outstanding coaches as well as managers. And some managers weren't that good to me, but they taught me how not to be as well. That's as important a lesson, how not to be as how to be. And so I've tried to take most of those lessons with me forward to pass it on to these young players.
I know you got to go get this lineup done, but I know you mean a lot to baseball and to a lot to these young players. What is it that you think it is that is important, why you want to stay in there and manage and help these young guys? What is it that you bring to the table?
Well, I mean, it's not totally unselfish. I mean, I got some goals, I like to reach too, because like you said, I just reached 1900, and 2000 is within, 100 more in range.
If you go to the World Series, you'll win that.
Well, that's what I want.
There you
also,
go.
There are a lot of guys looking up to me that would call me and ask me, how do you stay where you are in such a period of time? And I said, well, it hadn't been easy. I was just taking 5 organizations, and you got to have somebody to believe in you. You fight the battles, but you can't fight every battle. You got to pick and choose your battles. It's some of the things that my parents taught me or what I've learned along the way. There are a lot of young people that need some direction and need some advice. And as you get older, the people that advised you are gone, but their words are still here, and their spirit is still with you to help guide you. Because, one of my main questions in life is, who motivates the motivator? God motivates me, and I have my mom. My mom's still alive, and Hank, the words of Hank Aaron and my dad, and just different things. I remember asking Hank Aaron that question. I asked him, who do you go to when you're struggling? Because I don't care who you are, you're going to struggle at some point in time. And he told me, stand the man, without hesitation, stand the man, Mutual. And so right away, I got instant respect for stand the man. So Hank introduced him to me. And so, like I said, you got to have some people, that you believe in and what they're saying, and that they're telling you the truth, and have your best interest at heart, whether you want to hear it or not.
All right. Well, Stan was the man, and now you are the man in my eyes. We appreciate you, Dusty, and keep doing great things, man. Have a great season. And hopefully we can talk to you again later in the season.
All right, Marvin. I'll see you later.
All right. Take care, my friend.
Take care, my brother.
All right. I'll be calling you. All righty.
Okay, man. I'll see you.
Take care. All right, everyone. That was Dusty Baker, manager of the Houston Astros, and all-time manager, 14th on the Major League list of wins for a manager. So thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Around the Diamond. I'm Marvin Jackson.